President Delano Roosevelt, do solemnly swear that you will faithfully execute the office of President of the United States and will, to the best of your ability, preserve, protect, and defend the Constitution of the United States. So help you God.
I, Franklin Delano Roosevelt, do solemnly swear that I will faithfully execute the office of President of the United States and will, to the best of my ability, preserve, protect, and defend the Constitution of the United States. So help me God.
The more desperate the crisis, the greater is the demand for leadership. So it was in 1933 that two powerful forces were ordained and launched on a collision course.
Ascending to power at virtually the same moment in history. Franklin Roosevelt and Adolf Hitler dominated international affairs for a dozen years. And they provide us with a clear view of the many ways in which an individual can have a powerful impact on the course of our lives. His intensity and frenetic style mesmerized his followers. He was the master of persuasion. He infused the Gotterdammerung spirit of ancient Germany with mystical fervor. The spectacle was carefully staged, the ritual was performed time and again, and the German people responded from some deep and urgent need to find their shattered pride. One historian has noted that Hitler was not so much a vision as a force to the German people. A liberal democracy had let Germany flounder. Discouraged by ineffectual government, Germany's solid middle class was drawn to Hitler's radical splinter party. Not by ideas, but by the apparent confidence of its leader.
Die Partei ist Hitler! Hitler aber ist Deutschland, wie Deutschland Hitler ist. Hitler, Sieg! Sieg! Sieg!
understand the rise of Adolf Hitler, it is necessary to start in November 1918. The new German Republic had just been proclaimed. The German army was still at the front. A young army corporal named Adolf Hitler believed that Germany was betrayed at the Versailles Peace Conference by politicians he called the November criminals. Hitler denounced the treaty as a stab in the back and dismissed it as only a scrap of paper.
At the end of the war, German troops were in France and in Belgium, and Germany itself was victorious in the East, having defeated the Russians. It was rather easy to carry through the myth of the stab in the back, because from the point of view of most of the German public, as far as they knew, by virtue of the censorship imposed upon the press by the imperial government, Germany was winning the war in the fall of 1918, still winning, still occupying foreign territory. And there was a certain surface plausibility to the stab in the back, which enabled Hitler to use that and Versailles as a weapon against the Republican rulers of Germany.
Hitler watched in disgust in 1919 as communists tried to seize power in Berlin. The Spartacus revolt was supplied with money and weapons from the Soviet embassy. The Bolsheviks believed the time was ripe for a revolution in Germany. The fragile new Weimar Republic was on the verge of collapse. Chancellor Friedrich Ebert needed an enforcer to establish order. Gustav Noschke was willing to play the role of bloodhound and butcher. Noschke recruited an army of right-wing soldiers called the Freikorps to put down the revolt. Ebert became Germany's first president. He protested the Allied plans to impose severe peace terms on Germany, but to no avail. A shaky coalition held the Republic together, but the German army remained independent. General Hans von Sieg devised a scheme to circumvent the Treaty of Versailles, which limited the German army to 100,000 men. Von Sieg trained only potential officers, and by rotating recruits every 3 months, he created the nucleus of the future army. France, obsessed by her need for security against a rearmed Germany, sent troops to occupy the industrial Ruhr Basin. The French claimed that Germany had defaulted on reparations payments from the war. The Germans retaliated by refusing to work. The economy collapsed. In 1923, a 1 billion mark note would not buy a pound of butter. Civil servants, shopkeepers, teachers all lost their savings. They would later turn to Adolf Hitler to lead them out of financial ruin. In 1923, Hitler's famous beer hall putsch ended in disastrous failure. Hitler and 3,000 Nazis marched on Munich. Von Sieg's troops fired into the mob, killing 16 Nazis. Hitler was arrested and tried for treason. He was sentenced to 5 years in prison, serving only 9 months. But the aborted putsch more than served its purpose.
I think, though, Hitler made his impact less directly through the putsch than through the subsequent trial. A trial which, in early 1924, he very cleverly and cynically used as a forum for his ideas and his personality and for the National Socialist movement, which he represented. And even though he was sent off to imprisonment after the trial, he emerged from it also as a national political figure. And I think it was at that point probably that he reached the consciousness of most people.
Hitler's outbursts about economic strangulation were momentarily stifled. Chancellor Gustav Stresemann accepted the terms the American Dawes Plan, which allowed Finance Minister Schock to prop up Germany's economy and flagging spirits. Cabaret satirized politics, artist George Grosz and others concentrated on biting social criticism. the arts were angry. Republic struggled on into the 1920s with no cohesive program. Splinter groups from the left, right, and middle jockeyed for power with no single party dominant. All of them lacked one vital ingredient, a dynamic leader. Waiting in the background was a patient Adolf Hitler, convinced that the sham of democratic elections would fail. Germany made a pretense at democracy, but few politicians understood it. They had never really tried it before. Splinter parties continued fighting each other. In 1928, Hitler and his brown shirts could only manage to win 12 seats in the Reichstag. He knew that it would take more than elections to bring him to power. Then came the crisis he had been waiting for, the World Depression of 1929. Unemployment rose to nearly 5 million. The 1930 elections, the Nazis surged to respectability. They polled 6.5 million votes, becoming the second largest party in Germany. The communists also made big gains. While Hitler was winning the propaganda war, his thugs won the battle of the streets, terrorizing and intimidating opponents. Nazis' main issue was misery and hunger. Hitler promised his followers bread and jobs. After the ballots were counted, the Nazis had jumped from a mere 12 seats in the Reichstag to 107. It was Hitler's moment of triumph.
In America, President Herbert Hoover believed that somehow the American spirit by itself would rally the country past the crisis of depression. But rugged individualism faltered in the crush of depression and left Hoover frustrated and unable to deal with the country's economic collapse. The stage was set for FDR, whose greatest strength at that moment was his optimism and his own confidence.
I said from this platform to my nationwide audience that the election of the Democratic ticket is the best way to solve this problem, the best way to bring back prosperity. The election of Roosevelt, of God.
Let us all here assembled constitute ourselves prophets of a new order, of competence and of courage. This is more than a political campaign. It is a call to arms. Give me your help not to win votes alone, but to win in this crusade to restore America to its own people.
I do not see how, as a matter of practical sense, a government running behind $2 billion annually can consider the anticipation of bonus payments until it has a balanced budget.
All that tell the world about it now. Happy days are here again.
Franklin Delano Roosevelt was the tonic that America needed during the Depression. Brimming with confidence, he was cheerful and compassionate. He cared about, in his words, the forgotten man at the bottom of the economic pyramid. Rotten was his school, privilege his class. His patrician legacy was to help the less fortunate. Rotten prepared him for the inevitable next rung on the ladder of success, Harvard University. Young FDR had the credentials to do anything he wanted in life. At Harvard, he became an editor of the Crimson and devoted much of his time to crusades for campus reforms. He had position, wealth, and a sense of duty. In 1907, Vienna was the imperial city of Europe, the crown jewel of the Habsburg Empire. When he was 17 years old, Adolf Hitler left home in Linz, Austria, to pursue a career in art. The prestigious Vienna Academy rejected Hitler, saying he had no aptitude for painting. Vienna's community of Jewish artists and her intellectuals would become Hitler's twin hates. Successful artists like expressionist Egon Schiele, or playwright Max Reinhardt and his theater of spectacle, or the revolutionary composer Arnold Schoenberg, who broke new ground with his dissonant music, or Sigmund Freud, the father of psychoanalysis. He too was Jewish. In Vienna, Hitler was a total outcast, an unperson. Vienna left Hitler with a psychic scar. Following Harvard, FDR settled down to the urbane and privileged life. He married a distant cousin, Eleanor. Among their common relatives was Teddy Roosevelt. In the 1912 election, FDR opposed Uncle Teddy, as he was called, to work for Woodrow Wilson. As president, Wilson appointed FDR Assistant Secretary of the Navy. The First World War left twice-decorated, temporarily-blinded Corporal Hitler dedicated to avenge what he considered the betrayal of the German army. The 1921 polio epidemic left FDR a cripple for life. His suffering seemed to strengthen his character. The Nazis turned Hitler's humble beginnings into an asset and identified him with the struggling middle class. His war experiences gave him a volatile theme for the 1932 elections, the betrayal of Germany. There were five elections that year. Governments and chancellors changed regularly. None had a majority, and none could restore order. Hitler's brain trust was concerned over serious losses in the November 1932 elections. The excesses of Nazi bullyism had alienated many voters. Chaos that Hitler created in the streets would pay off behind the scenes in the power politics of Germany. Through bluff, intrigue, and agitation, Hitler forced Chancellor von Papen to resign. Von Papen struck a deal that would make Hitler chancellor and von Papen vice chancellor in a coalition government. On January 30th, 1933, Hitler became chancellor of Germany. But he still did not control the Reichstag, Germany's parliament. Then, on February 27, 1933, the Reichstag burst into flames. In less than 1 hour, the inside of the building was gutted. Chancellor Hitler rushed to the scene with Goebbels. Goering, who headed the police, blamed the fire on the communists. In a showcase kangaroo trial, a half-witted Dutchman, Marinus van der Lubbe, confessed that he alone had set the fire and admitted that he was a communist. Nazis forced President Hindenburg to sign an emergency decree against communist acts of violence endangering the state. It suspended all civil liberties and gave Hitler unlimited police power. Hindenburg, the aging militarist, had conspired with von Papen to name Hitler chancellor, confident they could control him. They were wrong. In time, Hindenburg would bow to the man he called the Bohemian Corporal.
The Nazis never won a majority in any of the elections which they contested. However, it is important to note that Hitler was not voted into power by a majority of the German people. In fact, the last free election prior to his appointment as German Chancellor marked the greatest losses suffered by the Nazis. In November of 1932, in the last election before Hitler's appointment as Chancellor, the Nazis lost more than 2 million votes and had their delegation in the national parliament severely reduced.
Germany was adorned with swastikas. Elections were 6 days away. Hitler was chancellor, but without a parliamentary majority. By the time the ballots were issued, it was clear the Nazis would not gain control of parliament. Hitler ran unopposed for chancellor, but open voting took place for seats in the Reichstag. The Nazis mustered 288 seats. They failed again to win the majority. The cheerful atmosphere of the polling places concealed Hitler's boldest plot. He used his emergency police powers to arrest all communist delegates. In one stroke, he gained the majority he needed to become absolute ruler of Germany.
The only thing we have to fear is fear itself. Nameless, unreasoning, unjustified terror, which paralyzes needed effort to convert retreat into advance. Only a foolish optimist can deny the dark realities of the moment. Values have shrunk to fantastic levels. Our ability to pay has fallen. The withered leaves of industrial enterprise lie on every side, and the savings of many years in thousands of families are gone. More important, a host of unemployed citizens face the grim problem of existence, and an equally great number toil with little return. I shall ask the Congress for broad executive power to wage a war against the emergency as great as the power that would be given to me if we were in fact invaded by a foreign foe. This nation is asking for action, and action now.
The next day, the New Deal was underway.
A cripple no man could cure was busy curing this crippled country. He improvised, he blundered, he failed often, he flattered and cajoled and threatened, he finessed the deck at times and misled, but he never showed outward signs of bitterness or defeat or hatreds. He kept at it and at it and at it. If a half man could do that, most of the rest of the people felt they could do no less. And Roosevelt reassembled America's energies and sense of purpose.
Franklin Delano Roosevelt became a symbol of hope, and the American people responded in typically American ways.
No!